dynamic stabilization in the surgical treatment of lumbar stenosis. Dr. Sabyener is a Turkish orthopedic surgeon. He was the first mentioned clinical importance of congenital lumbar stenosis. The lumbar stenosis may be seen as a congenitally, or it might develop due to aging process. In the surgical treatment of lumbar stenosis, we have different treatment methods. The first two ones were already presented by the lecturers. The routine procedure is to remove the lamina at the stenotic level or levels to increase the anteroposterior diameter of spinal canal. However, to achieve effective decompressive, fastest joints are also usually is removed. And two traditional surgical techniques are laminectomy with facetectomy and the facet sparing technique. The main problem with laminectomy is the development of instability, and to prevent this instability risk, facet sparing technique has been described. The unilateral microdecompression technique was presented by Dr. Koch. Theoretically, this technique diminished the instability risk. When we in surgical decision making process, we have to consider the biomechanical aspects of the spine, the effect of spinal elements on stabilization were described by Adamson Hutton in 1983. The facet joints has a major role in stabilization. Disc and annulus and ligaments are also play a role in this stabilization. And in classic traditional decompression surgery, most of these structures are totally or partially are removed. So when we look to the biomechanical studies, range of motion increases almost 30% following simple laminectomy. The bilateral hemilaminotomy is a less invasive technique, but still it increases the range of motion almost 15%. The development of instability following facet-sparing laminectomy is very wide spectrum in literature, from 8% to 30%. So it means that it is not also 100% offers stability. What happens after the compression of the posterior elements? The instantaneous axis of rotation moves anteriorly, and this causes much more force applied onto the disc, annulus, anterior longitudinal ligament, and also posterior longitudinal ligament. Unilateral removal of facet decreases the stability at axial rotation, and one-level laminectomy decreases the stability in flexion, while two-level decreases the stability also in upright position. For this reason, removal of facet joints or discectomy cause instability, high probability. The main problem with this patients is the slow disturbance of the anatomical integrity following surgery. For example, this surgery is operated in the United States due to L4-5 spinal stenosis, and facet sparing laminectomy was performed. After 4 years, she developed severe low back pain, and the radiographic studies demonstrated L4-5 anterior listhesis. In the literature, the study shows that following laminectomy, if the patient has normal radiology and simple decompression, cause 31% post-op anterior listhesis. If the patient has already anterior restenosis prior to surgery, the compressive surgery, following surgery, if you do not stabilize the spine, the anterior restenosis increases in 73% of the patients. But if you, even if you do fusion stabilization, the increasing listasis at post-op period is 26%. So the parameters indicate the high risk of instability were presented by Dr. Asaker in detail. I would like to mention multilevel decompression is also important. So simple decompression might be sufficient in limited patients, but most of the patients would like stabilization technique, and we have two stabilization techniques currently. The one is the traditional one, instrumentation with fusion, and in the recent years, the decompression with dynamic stabilization is also is a choice. We all know the numerous different complications with fusion. The fusion surgery is aggressive surgery, and we have to consider that these patients are not young, most of them. Most of them is over 60, so most of them have also comorbidities, and the fusion surgery carries high risk for these patients. Then we have to check the biomechanical data for the dynamic systems. I already mentioned these data in my yesterday's presentation. We have also done two different studies with dynamic system. Both of them showed effective stabilization in degenerated model in human cadavers, and the stabilization is almost equal to rigid stabilization. When we check the literature data, in common, all of the studies documented that the dynamic stabilization techniques offers effective stabilization. They offers load sharing principle, and they restores the disrupted segmental motion to a normal or close to normal kinematics. This is not valid for fusion technique, because the fusion in fusion technique you eliminate both the abnormal and normal kinematics of the fused segments. So currently we use dynesis or safinaz or ortho systems for multilevel systems. Because we eliminate the fusion procedure, we also eliminate the risks related to the fusion. So it is relatively simple surgery compared to fusion. Mortality and morbidity rates are low. Technique can be used for instability, which involves both the anterior and posterior column instability. And biomechanically, it provides nearly equal stabilization to rigid system. The costs are low. The rehabilitation is short compared to fusion surgery. And the revision surgery is easy. If I have time, I would like to show some cases. This is lumbar spinal stenosis with degenerative spondylolisthesis. In the first case, the patient is stabilized with fusion technique. And in the second case, these are two different cases, but almost similar cases in similar age group. The second case is stabilized with dynamic stabilization following decompression. The first patient showed pseudomeningocele which could be also seen in with dynamic stabilization. But she had continuous pain and burning sensation in both legs. So in the follow-up period, she developed screw loosening at S1 levels in the post-op third year. The other patient is also lumbar stenosis with coronal imbalance. The first one is decompression was performed due to canal and foraminal stenosis. She, for a while, she had a pain as compared to the preoperative period. The second patient, she complained only complained of neurogenic claudication. The first one is fused, multi-level fusion, decompression and fusion strategy was applied. For the second patient, multi-level decompression and dynamic stabilization was applied. In the post-operative second year, the patient who have operated with dynamic stabilization is satisfied with her operation. This is another case. Too many problems with the fusion, but the dynamic stabilization showed much less complications compared to fusion. So as a result, lumbar stenosis surgery is prone to develop instability, and dynamic stabilization technique offers satisfactory outcomes. Dynamic stabilization is less invasive method compared to fusion procedure, and the dynamics, however, we have to accept that dynamic stabilization is a new technology, and still the technique needs new horizons and concepts. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Any question for? Yes.
With the rigid one?
Whether with rigid or the dynamic, you fixed six levels. I saw in the first case, the canal stenosis was only two levels, and there was degenerative spondylolisthesis of L4 or over L5, but you fixed from T11 to S1. So what was the philosophy behind that?
This is not his case. He's showing a patient comparing fusion to dynamic, yes? Is it right? Yeah. And I think this comparison is we're comparing two techniques, but not the same surgeon. I mean, the one on the left who does, agree with you, why?
At the other operation, at the other hospitals.
Yeah. So it's nonsense to do this extensive fixation, and it was fixed in kyphosis also. This is why she lost the screws. She has screw loosening. No, he doesn't.
Yes, because of coronal imbalance, I think. I'll try to find.
Can you bring the slides, please?
I'm trying, yeah. Bir şunu açabilir misin?
Next one. After. Yes. Not the biggest one.
Okay. This case?
No, the one. Go on. Yes. After. Yes.